You are listening to a Clarkesworld Magazine podcast with your host and narrator, Kate Baker. Greetings, Clarkesworld citizens, and welcome to the sixth story for the month of October, issue 217. This story is brought to you by you. So thank you if you have taken the time to support us either by going to clarkesworldcitizens.com, patreon.com/clarkesworld, or have purchased a subscription. We cannot do this without you. Every bit helps to put this issue together each and every month. It pays for the artist, the podcast, the nonfiction, the authors who write the stories that you come to enjoy. And it helps pay the staff. So we thank you in advance if you have been a longtime supporter. And if you haven't yet, please consider doing so. We literally can't do this without you. Our story is titled Midnight Patron and is by Mike Robinson. Mike Robinson was born and raised in Los Angeles and is the award-winning author of multiple novels, including Walking the Dusk, Skunk Ape Semester, The Enigma of Twilight Falls Trilogy, and the collection Too Much Dark Matter, Too Little Gray. He is also a screenwriter as well as a senior editor with Wordsmith Writing Coaches. So my dear listener, I hope that you can sit back, relax, and let me tell you a story. Where the winds took him that day resembled many other places he'd been, broken and ravaged, confined by walls, a large hole in the ceiling, like a wood-toothed mouth yawning in desperate craving for the elements. It was another building, slowly relearning its place in nature. The crow descended, so abundant the numerous corners and crannies of this world, plenty of ripe food, virtually no resistance. Having been but a mouse from the nest when the light change happened, the crow recalled only blurry, noisy strokes of the world before. Then, abruptly, there'd been mass quiet. The smoke and the dust had settled, unveiling this endless feast in all directions. The actual layout of this building differed from many of those the crow had been to. Minimal consideration had been given to furniture or other people-derived amenities. The walls were white, the floor a dull series of dusty tiles. But something made up for this drabness, room after room of what looked like windows, though they weren't quite windows. He wasn't sure what to make of them, really. Each one peered into a different world, these worlds frozen in time. With some beak tapping, the crow realized they were hardly windows. They were not gateways to places of heightened color or floating abstract forms. They were as solid as the wall upon which they were hung, which intrigued him all the more. Could he fly into them somehow? The crow stared at one in particular, a series of lines and shapes intersecting in ways that were inexplicably, well, pleasing. Little thought occurred to him as to why this should be. Then there were the colors, playing off each other and bringing light and life and movement to it all. The crow had glimpsed similar color and line arrangements when surveying other buildings or when wandering the streets. Occasionally, he and his kind even conferenced on them or relieved themselves. But these eye pleasures were different. They were subtler, yes, but more vibrant. Looking closely, as one might at the soil of the earth, revealed motion there, an ongoing aliveness trapped in those confines. He fluttered on over to another piece with more recognizable subjects, a lakeshore gathering of many people, all wearing clothes none had been wearing, so he assumed, based on all the bodies so far scavenged. When the light change had happened, the image was oddly blurry, but even the blurriness enticed. This was a repository of things that defied the normal. Each one had a different sense to it, a unique scent, say, or a pulse of energy left over from when they came into being. If this was a sanctuary of some kind, though, it had not proven one for the actual people here. Several bodies were strewn about, all graying, crumpling. The meat still smelled okay, had not been picked at much. A few nibbles here and there, handiwork of the rodents, probably. The crow hopped off its perch, landed on the neck of one of the male bodies. His stomach grumbled. As the carcass lay prostrate, the crow could only see half its expression. It was a familiar one, too, dumb-eyed and gawking, an afterglow of disbelief on the thinning flesh. He cocked his head, secured his talons to the fabric of the clothes, With a snap of his neck, he drove his beak into the throat meat, pull-ripping skin, uprooting wormy tendons and green-tinted tissue. Then, he saw the woman. The crow recoiled, squawked, cocked his head, wings up, feathers bristled. The woman didn't smell like anything. In fact, strange as it was, the crow ascertained that his previous perch had unwittingly been the woman's elbow, which was raised, her arm bent behind the head. She was smaller and motionless, in all one metallic shade. She was neither alive nor dead. The crow's mind raced. The position of the woman, her form, was also pleasing. It reminded the crow of the trees he'd seen, or rivers he'd passed over. There was nature in it, but non-nature, too. And that heightened the nature somehow. The crow did not comprehend the scale of whatever had been partially revealed in his psyche, but he liked it. There was pleasure in it, distinct from consumption, mating, and play. In some respect, it felt like a sweet mixture of all three. He flew back to the frozen person, pecked softly at it, hard, impenetrable. It had none of the faded life aura around it, possessed by so many of the fresher bodies. But like the frozen window pictures, there was an energy there, whiffs of parental devotion. Who had made it? People. A new kind of hunger dawned on the crow, an intrigue traced by the soft light of wonder. He forgot about feeding his stomach and set about the rest of the building. He sat upon the rafters, strutted quietly over several square-shaped chambers, bright, colorful tombs for more bodies. More window pictures and more motionless figures, too. In one room, a series of window pictures that varied greatly in size. They were hardly as expressive or colorful as some of the others, though he recognized the geometric shapes featured. Unlike the other rooms, though, these pictures were all very similar, as if they'd been collected here much as sticks for a nest. Displayed on the opposite wall were people markings, pieces of their language. Among the crow's murder, there'd been some dabbling in writing, scratches in the dirt, say, or calculations done with rocks or leaves. But it was all thoughtlessly practical. Real communication was done bodily, vocally, energetically. He noted the shape and pattern of the letters, like they indicated a label of sorts, a name. And if these markings did represent a name, which represented an individual or a clan, did that mean that all the pictures here belonged to that name? The crow took a whirlwind tour of the other rooms. There were small markings next to each picture and each figure. They all varied. All such pieces were associated with specific names. New ideas formed in the virgin spaces of the crow's brain. In that space, surrounded by splintered roads and fallen buildings, all lying beneath sun-blurring clouds, where hour by hour, numerous small creatures grew braver beyond the shadows, something else returned, which was also small, and which might easily have been extinguished for generations untold. But as could be said about any earthly flame, that putting it out hardly guarantees one stray ember won't rekindle the blaze, so too could be said about this ember of inspiration on its dizzying return to this realm, soon to be oxidized by the burgeoning sensibilities of one particular bird. They'd swept southward across the devastation, the leaders, especially Tree Talon, so-called for the extra toes on both legs looked like tiny branches, were strict about keeping together as they harvested the ripe, meated city. On the day he discovered the building of visions, though, the crow had strayed from his kin. He felt peace and occasional solitude, which he knew made him strange. For several days in the building of visions, the crow enjoyed indulging alone, dual feasts of belly and eye. And given no shortage of bodies elsewhere, his sole purpose for returning there soon became that of the pictures and figures. He drank them in. They transported him. And then, one day, a new and distant thought flowered. I should do something like this. There was one image that came to the crow and it stuck. It was a vision of a crow, himself, in fact, only far larger than he was now. It stood to reason that all the creators of the figures and window pictures were dead. For all he knew, their meat might be sitting in his belly, he might have disposed of them in splatters of waste, in patterns not dissimilar, though not as intentional, to those displayed across the building's inner walls. Yes, they were dead, but their life still shone. They still spoke, still existed, yet their existence was so limited. The crow imagined magnifying his essence, leaving of himself a thing greater and bigger than any crow he knew. For days, the image of his grand work preoccupied him as he picked at the building's rotted bodies. Eventually, the rest of his murder caught up to him, and they began fluttering and hopping down the broken walls and the ragged, upheaved islands of tiled floor. "Many of these," said Tree Talon, indicating the bodies, "already picked." Tree Talon stood watching from one of the rafters like an emissary for the dusk growing behind him. His head bobbed spastically, but the focus of his heated gaze was on the crow. He could feel it. I find, the crow replied, raising his wings a little. Tree Talon launched himself down at the crow, drove his beak toward him, but deliberately missed, stabbing air. His wormy black tongue writhed, his neck feathers bristled. "Do not stray! Do not stray!" Tree Talon shouted. He stomped after the crow, all the more intimidating for the extra branch claws jutting from his legs. "Do not stray!" While most feasted, several other crows now watched the altercation, squawking their own oafish 2 cents. A hot white sensation burned in the crow. He wanted them away. He wanted to be alone. Why did he need them? These were feelings he'd had before, but never this intense. What had once existed as loose threads had formed a tight knot. Suddenly, these sensations cohered quicker. They were clearer, more striking. But the crow kept quiet and still. When Tree Talon finished his protest, he turned and flew off and started feasting on one of the fresher bodies. Some mixture of shame, embarrassment, anger, and spite rose in the crow. They were such big, exotic sensations with edges to cut. Part of him feared for his life if he wasn't going to be able to accommodate or relocate them. That's why he needed to be bigger. He looked at the metal woman standing there, beautiful and unmoving as always. A crow known as Elder Cousin landed on her shoulder, strutted a little down the forearm, leaned forward, and tail feather splayed sent a stream of waste down the woman's backside. Everything in the crow ignited. His cry bolted like a bladed thing from his mouth, and he raced toward Elder Cousin, this black fireball drawing the eyes of all his murder. He could feel them all watching, yes, could feel their alarm, but he didn't care. Driving Elder Cousin from his perch, he assumed sole position on the figure. He paced back and forth, his caw cries tearing at his throat. With as many eyes as he could feel, the crow could still distinguish Tree Talons, who now watched him with a caution not unlike that normally reserved for distant hawks. The crow, meanwhile, wasn't sure why Elder Cousin's defecation had so upset him. The crow dove right in and did, unburdened of all he didn't know. The only forethought was that the glorious image of himself as large as some of these buildings, it would be admired by all his kin, and in turn, so would he. There was also the question of where to put his figure. Why not the building itself? That nest of culture? Maybe. Was it too enclosed, though? For reasons the crow couldn't begin to comprehend, he wanted the sky and the wind and all the eyes of the earth, from those of other crows to ravens to those of the rodents and canines, to bear appreciative witness to his creation. It was the coming of a new life. Barely eating for the first day, the crow pecked out any loose debris that caught his fancy. Tire scraps, spark plugs, pipe fragments, leaves, nails, rocks, sticks, all things portable by beak or talon. Mostly, however, he culled from the very human bodies he'd been feasting on. The tissue tearing, tendon twisting, flesh clamping, bone dicing efforts that fed his and others' bellies was now, predominantly, in service of the work. And it was initially a hard-fought battle with instinct to not devour these ingredients now going toward his vision. The space he'd chosen the middle of an intersection only a block from the building, its faded, bent, shit-spattered signs of Wilshire and Fairfax, stripped of all prior significance, but now given renewed import to at least one of the city's surviving denizens. Much of the human tissue the crow used as a kind of adhesive between the inorganic matter. This was a flimsy solution, as it was rotting, and he soon realized left his vision to be patently vulnerable to the unthinking birds like Elder Cousin, who would encroach on the space and pick at the bits of carcass he'd collected. The crow cawed at these feathered Philistines. "Off, off, get off! Don't ruin, you ruin!" driving at them in a night shudder of fury. Working for 3 days, he grew hungry and weak. A fever had possessed him. There were even moments, in fact, when the crow lost sight of that vision he was hoping to assemble, and he was immersed in the sheer process of making. He became not a crow, but something else, a thing with no shape or name, without commitment to any of life's cruder demands. The first day and a half, his kin gathered in a ring around his activity, cawing their curiosity. Many hopped too close and helped themselves to too much. The crow lunged at one bird named Younger Sister, tearing several feathers from her left wing. On another, he pecked their neck until it bled. For another half day, they let him be, and it was bliss. Moments passed when the crow even forgot their existence. In this time, he put the finishing touches on the figure's two talons, made mostly of human rib cages and femurs and scraps of heavy clothing. Then they came, Tree Talon leading them. "What's wrong with you?" Tree Talon cawed. "What are you doing?" The birds stalked forward in a manner that might have been perceived as cautious, but which the crow knew to be an aggressive challenge. Tree Talon extended his wings, slightly raising his leg talon from which most of the extraneous branch nails jutted. Standing atop his malformed heap, the crow's heart began to race. Was he going to fight Tree Talon? That would really be the end of him. Yet what could he do? Then a new door in his mind inched open, spilling a thin ray of thought over his consciousness. "I make you," said the crow. "I make you a big you." He flew down to the crudely finished giant talons. You will be big. Celebrate. You lead us. Lead us." Immediately, Tree Talon's energy calmed. His wings folded down, his legs descended, his once fluffed feathered smoothening. "You make me big?" Tree Talon asked. "Yes, yes, yes." He cocked his head, looking a little confused. "That going to be me?" "Yes, yes, you lead us. Yes, lead us, you." Tree Talon turned and cawed a gentle warning to the rest of the murder that this new and mysterious endeavor was not to be interrupted, touched, or beaked by anyone other than himself and, of course, the creator in question. Fifth day of work, of exhaustively hopping, tearing, beaking, plucking, and poking so much material into place, and the crow could feel impatience tingling his skin. His motions grew quick, heedless, which only caused more to break or drop or misalign, which only fed more agitation that quivered violently through his veins. The image that existed in his mind was not the image coming to be before him. In fact, only the vaguest senses did it resemble anything like a bird, much less a crow, and much less him. Thankfully, Tree Talon and the others kept quiet. Most were off, flitting into new spaces, their voices in sporadic echo down the dust-simmered streets and alleyways. Sometimes the crow would get a feeling and glance skyward, and there against the sun, Tree Talon would be soaring at a steady, surveying altitude before picking up his pace and flying on. The crow did not communicate with him, but he knew he was being monitored. He kept on, however, because despite his frustration, the crow was enchanted by the process. He was learning a secret no other crow cared to know. He was unlocking a world within himself while shaping the outer world, twin sensations of pure play and serious purpose helixed in his soul. And the winds came. Driven not by the sea, but by the basin inland, they stamped down mountain and whirled and whooped like a flock of hot-tempered ghosts, kicking up muscled with great plumes of amber dust and unleashing an arsenal of gravel and bone and shrapnel and glass. Sensing those initial hot, dry gusts, the crow panicked. What would become of his work? He'd not had time to perfect it. Whatever control he had had scarcely existed, and now the winds threatened to take away even that. A massive dust cloud rose northeast of them like some shapeless organism, for which all this destruction had been but a mere tenderizing of its feast. Tree Talon and the other crows circled above, fear sharpening their voices, hastening their arrhythmic movements. Must leave, Tree Talon squawked. Forget, leave. The crow stood atop his figure. It was hardly complete and hardly loyal to that founding vision, but no one else cared for it. And as the other crow zipped closer and closer, cajoling him, as the hot, dry winds hammered at him, he was prepared to protect it in whatever way he might, even as scraps and chunks were already peeling off and scattering. The others had performed a protective cyclone about him. The crow felt a swell of devotion to his brothers and sisters, and renewed appreciation. He had devoted himself to an enterprise none of them understood, yet they refused to leave without him, refused to allow him to die with or for his dream. Coming! It's coming! Even as all the other creatures had vacated or hidden, as the giant cloud loomed half mile out, then a quarter mile, then a few blocks away. The windstorm seized them, whirling them about as they stretched their wings and struggled to steady themselves. Tree Talon cried mostly inaudible cries, with a hesitation. The crow removed himself from his work, relinquishing all purpose these past days had brought him. He tried to keep an eye on what became of his creation. Most of it, however, remained invisible under the roiling plumes of ash smoke. Just then, something broke through the dust floor, like an aircraft piercing through a thunderhead, or a whale breaching the surface. In frantic, fevered glimpses, the crow tried to watch for what it was. He saw the patterns he'd used, the sticks and fabric and metals he'd endeavored to collect into a giant bird wing, and a resounding sadness filled him that he would not only have to abandon his work, but watch it be torn apart like so many fresh carcasses. The other crows, including Tree Talon, noticed it too, and there was a moment in this chaotic void that moved slower than other moments as the crow's shapeless creation rose up and filled the space between them and unveiled for them its rugged physiology, hanging there like some creature auditioning for its role in nature. The wind slammed it, cutting under the better-formed wing and splaying it much like the feather of a real crow, and then the talons turned menacingly and the huge body creaked, and bursting across the minds of all watching crows was some shadow of a greatness to be as the wind sculpted it, listed it, the elements adding to the might and the vision once lacking. And then that moment passed, and the clouds swallowed the figure, and the wind took up the many parts and took them, and it took the crow and all others howling away and away. The crow awoke in an unrecognizable place, though he was not alone. He thought, I don't want to be alone again. The others stirred around him. They were scattered over rubble heaps and old windowsills and barren trees. Some, like Tree Talon, appeared barely affected by the winds which still issued its warm, dry breath, though the storm had passed. Pain throbbed in the crow's right foot, and he could barely put pressure on it. This worried him, forcing him to flutter hop. For this distinction, he was not happy, though it could have been worse. Elder cousin was missing, and younger sister was among those thought dead. He felt a pain of regret, especially about younger sister. Tree Talon called at him specifically, beckoning him with gestures of his hooked beak. There was a new softness to his energy. Reluctantly, the crow hobbled forth. Make, said Tree Talon. Though the crow suspected what the elder was saying, he wasn't sure. Again, make, again. He understood. He was also struck by that softness in Tree Talon's eyes, which up close registered as something like awe. Glancing out over his weary, rustling, hopping, fluttering siblings, the crow felt the same from them, too. They cawed at him and spoke amongst themselves. Like, make life. Large life, he thought. They saw it. That day, the remaining murder overseen by Tree Talon and the crow began scavenging. Gathering. What are your thoughts on the story? You can send me an email. I'm Kate at clarksworldmagazine.com. I hope you've enjoyed this story. We have one more left for you for the month of October. And I do hope you can listen, should you so choose. And until then, my dear listener, I bid you a very fond and hopefully very temporary farewell.